Hey, how y'all doing? This is Mongo Slade, and today we're going to do an AEW year review. So we're going to talk about 2020. Now, we're going to talk about everything. That would be entirely too long. I just jotted down some of the big stories of the year. And basically, we just going to talk about stories, not going to talk about matches or individuals. We may talk about some individuals as far as in an individual context, but we're not going to talk about, you know, match quality or match types or anything like that. To me, that stuff goes in the eyeballs and goes away. I couldn't tell you what match just took place, if we're being honest. In some of these situations, man, that stuff barely sticks. You know, it's not like when I was a kid and wrestling was like peanut butter. It stick to the roof of your mouth. Now it's like I watched so much of it, it's hard to tell, you know, what I saw and what I didn't see. So instead of making a fool out of myself and digging through the old pay-per-views and all the old shows, trying to figure out what my favorite matches were, I'm just going to talk about basically some of the big stories of events. That's basically what this channel is about. It's about storytelling and news, opinions, headlines, stuff like that. So this 2020 was the first full year of AEW's existence. And it was rocky, of course, as it was for everyone because of the pandemic. And then they decided to move to Daly's place, where the shows hit a skid, really hard skid for a while, because they didn't have the big markish crowd that they usually have. As markish as the crowd is, man, the crowd helps when it comes to AEW, because they really hype up a lot of the more mediocre to average performers that they have. Of course, they make the guys who are, you know, good seem like they're great, but they take some of the guys who are just okay and make them seem like they're great too. But they didn't have that this year. So one of the bigger stories, the biggest story of AEW's first full year, let's say, is obviously Brody Lee's passing, which just took place on, I believe, the day after Christmas, December 26th. That was horrible. That was, you know, some really dark shit. And, you know, rest in peace, Brody Lee. I'm not going to go into it. I've already done a video basically talking about my thoughts about Brody Lee. I'm not going to go through that, but it would be remiss if I didn't mention that first. That is the biggest story that has taken place in AEW all year, is that they had one of their performers die under contract. That's not anything, you know, nothing can top that, even though it was at the end of the year. So what we saw the introduction of the TNT title. So the TNT title, everyone thought it was going to be a television belt. So it was going to be like, that's what everybody thought it was going to be. And then it wasn't. They had this big tournament around it that ended up with Cody and Lance Archer. And Cody won, and Cody had a decent run that saw him bring in all of these independent wrestlers to give them a shot. So that's one of the things that, you know, I thought was a bright spot. Despite the fact that I thought a lot of those guys were definitely not ready for prime time, like Warhorse, for fuck's sake. Jesus. And then the internet made it seem like this guy was like a really big deal. And I was just like, what the fuck? He looked like a Road Warrior cosplay act. He was just wild mediocre. You know, sorry if you're a fan, but he was just like wild mediocre to me. I didn't give a shit. Of course, this brought us Eddie Kingston, who ended up being one of the stars of the year. I was a big fan of Eddie Kingston. So, I mean, the tournament did a good job. You know, did a good job of highlighting Lance Archer for a short time, even though he didn't really do much afterwards. But it brought us Eddie Kingston. The title itself brought us Eddie Kingston. Now, as we speak, Darby Allin is the champion, which is the right move. You had three title changes within the year because Brody Lee had a short run while Cody went off and did a TV show, the Go Big Show. So, you know, looking back on it, of course, I'm glad Brody Lee got that run. I'm glad he also got that pay-per-view main event. I think it was it wasn't a pay-per-view main event, was it? That was Eddie Kingston. That was, he wrestled at, I guess, the main event of the show. Maybe an episode of Dynamite that was main evented by Brody Lee. I don't remember. See, I don't remember things. So maybe if you go, that's the beauty of this channel. I don't remember shit. So I'm pretty smart, but I forgot. My brain sometimes has Swiss cheese memory. So I don't remember exactly what happened. But the TNT title was introduced this year. It was a mid-card title. It was needed for the amount of talent and the expansion of the AEW brand. You have to have more than one title. They have not individualized this title yet. They have basically given it meaning by saying that the TNT title is the face of TNT. Like, okay, but what does that mean? Right? What does that mean? Like, you know, everyone thought it was going to be a TV title because TV titles have time limits, but every AEW match has time limits. And usually you individualize the title by giving it individual rules. Weight limit, certain time limits, limit the amount of people who can wrestle for it. Like, if it was the TNT title was you could only wrestle independent stars, or you had to wrestle independent guys that didn't come. Let's say you had to wrestle three independent acts that weren't under contract. That would make the title interesting, because then they will constantly be looking for people outside of AEW to bring in to wrestle. But that's not a rule or anything like that. But the TNT title is fairly interesting. The finished product is a lot better than the unfinished product, that's for sure. But it was still a weird thing. This year also saw a lot of veterans jump ship from WWE and other promotions to AEW. Individuals like Matt Hardy, Miro, Sting, Brody Lee, Lance Archer from New Japan. See what I'm saying? What the fuck is his name? I can't believe I can't remember his name. I didn't write it down. Matt Sydal, that's his name. So Matt Sydal jumped ship from Ring of Honor. So there was a lot of people who migrated towards AEW. Brian Pillman Jr., Ricky Starks, Brian Pillman Jr. came from MLW, Ricky Starks from the NWA. So there was a lot of different people. Serena Deeb also from the NWA, so was Thunder Rosa. They all came over. All these people are sort of veterans of the wrestling business. And AEW had struggles in trying to find a place for all these people because they brought in so many. And then, of course, it also runs contrary to what AEW was supposed to be. Like, AEW signed Sammy Guevara and Kip Sabian and Darby Allin and all these people, telling the world that these are going to be the future stars. But then when the ratings started to sag, they were kind of like, hit the button. Thankfully, Stanford released all of these people. FTR was able to jump. And, all these other people were able to jump. And they were thankful that WWE didn't want Eddie Kingston, because Eddie Kingston was able to get brought in. And they have really bolstered the AEW roster, but they have struggled with fully integrating these people, because some of them just aren't doing anything. You know, Miro is lost in the weeds. So is Lance Archer. So is, I just said the guy's name. I can't remember it again. Matt Sydal. You also had Jake Roberts, who came in to be the mouthpiece for Lance Archer, but he seems to have just basically vanished. I know he's been there, but he's basically done nothing. So you had, Matt Hardy come in, and, they were pushing Matt Hardy. They looked like they were going with Matt Hardy and Jericho for a while, and because they did the whole stupid thing where Jericho was feuding with the drone, and he was arguing with the drone and all that type of stuff. And then that shit hit a hard left. And the best we got out of it was the Stadium Stampede situation, which Matt Hardy was in that match, but he didn't really interact with Chris Jericho at all. So they never really paid off the Jericho-Matt Hardy feud. They didn't fully pay that off. But it was needed for AEW in order to grow. They needed an influx of new talent. And throughout the year, they did bring in, and they also brought in younger talent. Top Flight, The Acclaimed. Again, I said Ricky Starks already. Brian Pillman, Powerhouse Hobbs. They did bring in some younger talent that were inexperienced, but they just don't focus on them, And some of them are not ready. I will gladly say that, Private Party are not ready. Top Flight, The Acclaimed, you're not ready. But I don't know how they're going to get ready. That's the thing. Other than doing the job, I don't see how, you can't just be in a warehouse somewhere practicing, and some of these people are 26, 27 years old. Like, they need to go out there and do it and look stupid and grow on screen, That's the trials and tribulations of being on TV. Like, some of these guys, like Top Flight, are really young. They'll be okay. But some of these other guys, they're like 26, 27, and they're kind of looking goofy on TV. It's like, I don't know what to tell you, but you got to keep going out there and keep trying it. And and AEW is sort of punished for having these guys on the roster because they are not people, you know, the audience, the markish audience will give them a chance, obviously. But a lot of the wider audience are turned off by the weirdness of them. You know, some of the oddities that you see floating around there, like Serpentico, you're like, what in the hell? Why is this guy here? Like, you know, people are kind of like, click, change the channel or whatever. And they're in this, it's a one-sided ratings war, if we're being honest, which they're winning, but they're not winning by much, you know, except for in the quote-unquote demos where, you know, that sort of stuff matters. It seems like it matters a lot to them. It doesn't really matter that much to everyone else, though. But so they're trying to figure out how to best utilize the new talent that have been brought in and the older talent which have been brought in. And what essentially they've done is that they tried to create tent poles where you have your Cody bubble, your Jericho bubble, and your Young Bucks bubble. And then, of course, your John Moxley bubble. And basically, you know, when you enter this bubble, you become within the sphere of this person, and at least you get some benefit from being within the sphere of this person. Like, you know, let's give you an example, MJF. Even though MJF was there in the first year, MJF entered when he went in the beginning of 2020, he was in the Cody bubble. So he was feuding with Cody. He was getting television time because he was working with Cody. And then he sphered out of the Cody bubble into the John Moxley bubble. And then he sphered from that into the Chris Jericho bubble. So he's just kind of been floating from bubble to bubble. Meanwhile, the tag teams are mostly in the Young Bucks bubble. They can't do anything without being in that tag team, though. You know, like they have no, there's no way of them doing anything else. But when you have the older talent, you know, your Miros, your Matt Hardy. I don't mean old as in old, old, old. I'm just talking about people who've been on TV for a while or who have been around for a while. If you was in WWE or in TNA, I don't consider you a new talent. Let's put it like that. Or a young talent. So let's put it like that. So somebody like Lance Archer, he comes in right under the Cody umbrella. And then he moves onto the Moxley umbrella. And then he disappears. Because it's like, where else does he go? You know? So... They've had a problem really integrating these young talents into the show. So you also one of the things that that kind of didn't help with that is the dominant run of Jon Moxley. Now a lot of people love Jon Moxley as a champion. Again, I thought he was cool for a little while. Like I said, I've already said that he's like the John McClane. At least I hope that's the name of the character from Die Hard of AEW. He has a sort of Western coolness to him. I like Jon Moxley, I really do, but I just didn't think he was the best that, you know, the people on the internet was basically blowing it out of proportion because most of his matches are pretty much the same. And then his work is, you know, either too light or too sloppy and not really all that good. But his stuff is basically character and personality, which is fine because that's similar to John Cena. You know, John Cena was, you know, didn't execute very well. You know, some of John Cena's kicks look like shit. Sometimes, you know, definitely his submission holds look like shit. You know, the same thing with Jon Moxley, where his execution of moves doesn't look very good. Like, his knee strikes are absolutely terrible. But he has a character that you can buy into because it feels natural. It feels real. And he's done a really great job throughout the year. I wasn't really feeling the Jericho feud, especially considering the whole him faking that he had his eyeball taken out. And then, but him winning the title was the right thing to do. Him going on that that long run was the right thing to do, too, because he established the title. And he was able to have those barn burners with Brody Lee and Lance Archer and Eddie Kingston and really have those ballsy main event matches, you know, where guys got to go out there and hit hard and fight and, you know, work a heavyweight championship style. That he likely, you know, is kind of a mix of him, his stuff on the indies and the stuff that he learned in WWE. It gave, you know, it kind of added some legitimacy to the AEW title that, and I think he did more for it than Jericho did. Like, I think Jericho was basically just a coat rack. you got to put it on Jericho because Jericho is the most known guy in on the company. He's been around for 30 years. You have to, you know, it seems a little silly to do it, but you had to. You know, you had to put the belt on Jericho. But now you need somebody, you need a horse that can run. You need a stallion. So now you put your show horse away, you put it on your stallion, you let your stallion go. John Moxley's a little bit older. He's like in his mid-30s, I think. But he can still go. And he's a name. He's fresh off of a WWE run where they actually treated him fairly well on his way out. So it wasn't that bad. And, you know, he had new energy, fresh energy, and new motivation. So it turned out to be okay. But then afterwards, what we saw was after Jericho was the champion, he sort of dissolved into silliness. And that's another big story, is that every Jericho story since he lost the title has been silly. You know, the dinner debonair, his arguments with the drones and with Matt Hardy and the Mimosa Mayhem stuff with Orange Cassidy. And now this silly shit he's doing with MJF. And it's just been comedy. I mean, I know Jericho does a lot of comedy. Yes, Jericho does a lot of silly stuff. That's always been his gimmick. But it's feeling very pronounced now because it doesn't feel like he's actually elevating talent anymore. It sounds like he's pretty much indulging himself and just, you know, doing silly shit because he can. I think that his ego won't accept that he's not really helping. You know, like, did Chris Jericho really elevate Orange Cassidy to anybody? You know, I don't think so. I think him working with Orange Cassidy was an opportunity. But then you had them doing the debate segment, the campaign debate segments with Eric Bischoff. And people would say, oh, well, I think that did a pretty decent rating, I believe. But most people were just kind of like, okay, just like the dinner debonair, people talked about it. It's like, okay, people talked about it, but what about the long term? You know, did it have a long term positive effect? And I don't think Jericho has done anything other than be the champion in AEW that has had a long-term positive effect. The best thing he's done is drop the belt. Like, that was the best thing Chris Jericho has done in AEW. You know, and you could say this, I don't think you could say the same thing for Cody. I think Cody has been a good spokesman for the company. I think he's been a good professional as far as doing PR and different things like that, interacting with people, even though I think that Cody allows himself to get bullied online a lot. You know, especially when it comes to race and gender stuff, because he's very defensive. He kind of needs to stop doing that. You know, he needs to be a little bit more firm that, you know, and stop arguing with weirdos online. But Cody has done a great job. You know, John Moxley pretty much disappears. If he's not on TV, he pretty much doesn't do anything, which is actually good for the character and good for the company. You know, he's not in the way. He's taking stupid chances with the whole, you know, wrestling and mud shows and stuff like that, but he was going to do that anyway. He was doing that before, and he got himself a staph infection, but, you know, that was weird. Kenny Omega taking the title was good, too, because Kenny Omega is another stallion. He's another guy that you can – he's a workhorse guy, though, and they're trying with – and I love the Invasion of Impact stuff. I don't like the execution. I love the idea, though. Like, the execution has been dumb because nobody in Impact seems to care, and nobody in AEW seems to care. But you got Tony Schiavone and Tony Khan dissing Impact on Impact, and everybody else that's on Impact is ignoring it. You know, like, Rich Swann is kind of getting offended, but it took way too long for him to get offended, and he's the only one. You know, like, nobody, none of the other champions are upset. The tag team champions, well, the tag team champions are the Good Brothers, but there's no one else that's seemingly upset that, you know, Kenny Omega is trespassing on their property and, you know, talking trash and everything. It's not having the effect. And I think part of it is because Impact is taped. You know, maybe the next round of tapings will have a little bit more integration, but that'll be next year. That won't be in 2020. So. But Kenny Omega is a guy they tried to make into a big star. And I know that in some people's world, Kenny Omega is a big star because he was a big star in Japan. Well, let me tell you, the United States is not Japan. Trust me. If you know, if you can't put somebody on the cover of a magazine and the magazine sells, they don't care in the United States. You know, in Japan, they may be able to care about your tope con hiro, you know, but nobody gives a shit in the United States, which is why John Moxley was the perfect champion. Jericho and Moxley were the perfect two guys to bring AEW to this level. Now they have to, you know, but they were character guys. You know, Jericho is a character heel and Moxley is a character babyface. Now you have Kenny Omega, who is a workhorse, who virtually has no character at all. And now they're trying to interject that character via Don Callis and, you know, the whole Kenny Omega wanted to take over wrestling when he was a kid and all that stuff. So it's been weird. Of course, there is also the injuries to Matt Hardy, who was absolutely obliterated in a match with Sammy Guevara. The recklessness of AEW has also been a story all year. You know, Sammy Guevara recklessly throwing a chair, smashing Matt Hardy in the head with it, busting him wide open, fucked him all the way up. And then he almost killed him in that last man standing match. He almost died in that. Alex Reynolds gets knocked unconscious. I don't give a fuck what he said. He was clearly unconscious, laying in the middle of that ring. And he was, you know, dragged over to the corner and tagged out. He was slumped in the corner at one point. So a lot of that stuff has kind of been going under the radar, is how reckless it's been in AEW with the injuries. A lot of the women have been injured. I think every woman on the roster has been injured at least once. You know, I'm talking for a shoot. Like, Britt Baker had two serious injuries in 1 year. When she definitely got her nose broken earlier in the year. And then I think they dropped somebody. I think, was it Chris Statlander that got her leg destroyed? There was another chick. There's been like three broken legs in the women's division alone. Because was it Shana? Was that her name? The girl who got injured? She also got injured, and Chris Statlander also got injured, and Britt Baker was also injured. Like, and then, you know, you had all of those injuries in the women's division. It's completely destroyed the division, as well as the pandemic, you know, trapping Riho and Emi Sakura and Yuka Sakazaki over in Japan. You know, they were going to be the cornerstones of the division, the Joshis. And they got trapped in Japan. You know, they lost Pac for a long time. But the injuries has been a big thing. Because they've been very, very reckless in AEW. And I'm talking seriously reckless, because, you know, you have a lot of very serious injuries with wrestlers being injured for a long time. You know. And this is also a problem somewhere else. But we'll get to that into a different video. So, that's been like a mix of things that have been going on in the first year of AEW. They've done a good job, a decent job, let's say. And I don't want to say good. Let's say a decent job with MJF. They've been doing a decent job of mixing up storylines. So, you know, some guys are featured more than others on different times. That's a good way of looking at things. You have different guys in the main events every week. But they've done like two or three tournaments this year. You know, it's kind of like they're doing a lot of tournaments because they really don't have any other storyline ideas. But AEW's first full year in operation has been a struggle. You know, their format seems to work out for them, where they do mostly matches. You know, that seems to hold people's attention as long as people care about what the matches are. They have gone back almost completely backwards on their promise for women's wrestling. You know, there's almost none on some of these shows now. How you feel about that. But I know that that's one of the things that they promised, that they were going to focus on women's wrestling, and they haven't. And part of that is because their division has been depleted by injuries and a pandemic. Another thing is they noted that the women's are not a ratings draw, so they don't focus on them. You know, they put a lot of women on dark. You know, like when they had the women's tag team tournament, which I could have talked about, but it was, you know, not the focal point of Dynamite. They put it on a different day. You know, like they have been treating the women as ratings poison, which I guess they essentially are. You know, they have really just kind of been avoiding putting the women on TV for an extended period of time, which is something they said they weren't going to do. They said they were going to focus on the women. They haven't. But they did fulfill their obligations when it comes to focusing on tag team wrestling. They've done a good job with that. Their main event scene has been decent. They have had some decent main event guys. You know, they're taking some chances when it comes to rotating different guys. You know, you have Kingston in there and Brody and Lance Archer. Even though they're essentially the three almost similar guys because they're bruisers, essentially. But you've also got MJF made his way to the main event at one point. So you got this decent mix of guys, old and young talent. They try to bring surprises in every week, which is not a good idea, because TNA tried that, ECW tried it. You cannot live off of surprises. Eventually, you're going to run out. Eventually, you run out of surprises. You know, you can't hotshot every week. It just doesn't work that way. You know, people don't want to be surprised every week either. Because if it's a surprise every week, then, especially when it's a surprise as in they're bringing in somebody new every week, then what happens to all the other people? This was the problem with they had this influx of talent. It was the beautiful thing about WWE releasing all these people at one time. That's because as they play, as the independents and everyone played Hungry Hunky Hippos to snatch these guys up, it became some people had a difficult time integrating these people into the companies. Like AEW signed quite a few of those people, brought them in, and then one of them, Matt Cardona, just disappeared off the face of the planet. He like slid right off the screen. Like he wrestled for like a month. He probably made 3 or 4 appearances and then he vanished, you know, because it's just, they had too many new talents coming in, you know? And then of course they were still bringing in people from Impact. They brought in Brian Cage. They were still bringing in people from the NWA because they brought in Ricky Starks. So they were still bringing people in while they were trying to find spots for everyone else. And that's really been a major problem for AEW is they have not fully integrated their roster. They don't know who's a main event act, who's a mid-carder, and to what degree. You know, they're trying to just book everybody as a main eventer, giving certain people too much time. And it's not a good idea. You know, like, it's not a good idea to have, you know, certain guys wrestle 15, 20-minute matches every week. You don't need that, you know. You shorten some of those matches, especially if they're cold. Especially if a match is cold, it needs to be shorter, you know. I'm sorry if you're not going to be able to do all your flippity-doos, but you need to do it shorter. You know, like, get in, get somebody over, and get out of there. You know, instead of having 5 long matches on the show, probably have 4 short ones. Or, you know, or not 4 long ones, but 6 short ones, 7 short ones. Like, instead of having Top Flight lose to higher level tag teams in matches that, oh, it's a good showcase for them, put them in there with jobbers and let them win. Like, but oh, but we do all of our jobber matches on Dark. It's like people don't watch Dark. I don't watch Dark. Certain people don't watch Dark. We might want to see what these guys got, but we don't want to watch Dark. So do it on the show. You're supposed to be old school wrestling anyway. You can do 3 or 4 straight up jobber matches on the show without losing anybody, without anybody getting pissed off. And I certainly won't be angry if you do jobbers. I don't mind jobber matches. I grew up on them, you know. Throw out a Knuckleball Schwartz or a Griff Garrison that gets beaten 7 minutes. I don't care. 3 minutes. I don't give a shit. Show me the other guy. Show me the guys that you want to be a star and then show me why you want them to be a star. Let them talk. You know, and show me what you see in them. That's what I want. So those are the big stories of AEW's first year. As far as I'm concerned, I'm pretty sure I'm missing some things, but I'm not going to go in through, like, I'm not going to go through the matches and all that type of stuff. That's just too much. I think Jericho has been a great disappointment in 2020. I think he was a good champion, but I do think that he has basically given up and stopped caring after he was champion, because he's not his responsibility anymore. So he used to be sort of the ambassador for AEW. Now he's sort of embarrassing them. like Jericho was the reason they got ridiculed by the NBA Twitter. You know, Jericho, you know, has been a lightning rod for politics and perform, you know, his politics, being a Trump supporter, things that he said on his podcasts, or Jericho performing during the pandemic, traveling to perform, whether it's for, I was about to say Judas, whether it's for his band or somebody else's band. So Jericho has become a very, he's become a double-edged sword. He used to be the strength of the brand, that people who always wanted to see Chris Jericho be a top guy somewhere and, you know, a solidified top guy, they were attracted to AEW because that's what they saw. They called Chris Jericho, a guy who was treated as a mid-carder in WWE, finally get his run at the top, finally get made into the huge star that, you know, we all thought he was. And then they started saying, oh, Jericho's a Trump supporter. Oh, Jericho doesn't take the pandemic seriously. Oh, Jericho is fat. And now it's starting to really become a negative. You know, Jericho being sensitive on Twitter about his weight, being sensitive on Twitter about the demos and the days that they lose and the ratings. He has to go out there and explain how they lost and, you know, taking shots at WWE or taking shots at, you know, different companies and doing the little things. You know, it's just been, he's kind of been cutting both ways. He's made as many scars on AEW as he has, you know, given them points. And I don't know what you do about that, because he's still the biggest star in the company. So, so I don't know what to tell you. You're not going to be able to. Sting is a great ambassador. Sting is great. But Sting can't go out there and work. So, you know, you can't just be like, well, we're going to put Jericho on the shelf because we got Sting now. It's like, you know, because Jericho's 10 years younger than Sting, you know, so maybe even 11 years younger than Sting. But they do have some, a decent stable of talent. They're not doing a bad job. They introduced some good guys. You know, Miro is good. Matt Hardy walks. Matt Hardy and Eddie Kingston. I'm glad I talked myself into this, because I knew I was forgetting something. If somebody walks with a pronounced limp, like Matt Hardy or Eddie Kingston, that probably should be it for them. That's just my opinion. Like, I've been watching some Evolve from on the network. Eddie Kingston has been limping for a long time. Like, that limp that he walks with, I don't know where that came from, but but that's weird. Like, that really affects your work. And that's probably why Eddie Kingston can really only have very short matches or garbage matches. Like, I don't think that he can do much else. And that's probably why Matt Hardy also needs to be in a six-man tag situation and can't be out there doing singles matches. I think that they're, you know, physically probably should be transitioning to manager roles. And I think that's pretty much what they're doing with Eddie Kingston, is transitioning him to a manager role and moving them away from actual in-ring wrestling. Maybe that's what we're going to get to see in 2021, as we'll see Matt Hardy sort of, you know, pushed aside. I hate to put it like that, because I know a lot of people are big fans of Matt Hardy too. And they say, well, Matt Hardy's finally getting the opportunity to be what he wants to be. It's like, yeah, but what Matt Hardy wants to be is schizophrenic and stupid. Like, he's created this idea of doing several different characters at one time. He doesn't know whether he's a heel or a babyface. He doesn't know whether he's a human being or a mystical wizard from, you know, that's 10,000 years old. You know, he wants to dress weird on one show. And it's like, if you're going to have this kind of thing, it should be at least some type of internal consistency to go with it. And he's just sort of pretty much thrown that out the window. You know, like he's pretty much thrown out the window. And I think he thinks that he's Mick Foley, who, you know, can go from Mankind to Dude Love, from Mankind to Cactus Jack. And it's like, maybe, but, you know, that's kind of hard to do. And then when you're just Matt Hardy, everybody just sees you as, you know, Matt Hardy, the guy who Lita cheated on. Matt Hardy, the guy, the other Hardy. You know, you need to establish who you are before you can start going out doing crazy characters. And he got over doing crazy characters in TNA, and he just got the idea that that's just what I'm going to do. I'm just going to keep doing crazy characters. And this stuff isn't working. It's not connecting. You know, and that's why they haven't really been focusing on Matt Hardy, despite the fact that he was one of the bigger signings that they made this year. I could just talk all day about what they've done with Miro. It's been a disaster. The whole Miro thing has been an absolute disaster from the word go. His partnership with Kip Sabian has been a disaster. The only thing that can completely sell it, the only thing that can save it, is if Miro destroys Kip Sabian's wedding by beating the shit out of Kip Sabian, busting him open, and leaving him a bloody mess in the middle of the ring. If he does that, okay. But then you'll have to explain why he was hanging out with this guy all this time just to kill him later. You know? But it's just, it's that has been the major weakness of AEW. They have all of this talent. They just have not been focusing on them because they only care about the tentpole guys. They only care about Cody, Jericho, Moxley, and Omega. That's really it. You know, even in the Young Bucks, because they have to have a tag team division. They don't care about any of the women because none of the women are tentpole acts. You know, most of the mid-carders, unless you're working with Cody or Moxley or Jericho or something like that, you don't exist. And then, hell, some of the people who even work with them disappear. Like Santana and Ortiz. Like, they don't do anything. They just do jobs. You know? So, it's very difficult. And this is just part of the growing pains. Maybe they need to shed some talent and not try to be like WWE, where they just sign a bunch of people and then put them on dark, or just sign a bunch of people and then put them in their training facility. They probably just need to let some of these people go. You know? And most of them they need to let go are their friends, like Brandon Cutler and Dr. Luther and all those people. They need to go. You know, sorry. They need to go. But that's my, that's just some stuff that I've been thinking of when it comes to the first year of AEW. But let me know what you guys think in the comment section below. Like this video, share this video, subscribe to this channel. I thank you guys for your time. Send me money, please. And I'll talk to you guys later. Peace.